know, you always hear about people. They go through their life and they say things like, well, forget about college. I'm 45. I don't know what I want to do with my life, right? Well, I've known what I've wanted to do with my life for my entire life, and I feel fortunate because of that.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to the Captain's Brief. We got a hot war in Ukraine with Russia. We've got G conspiring with Putin, and the Queen is sadly passed. I have to say, we'll start off with the Queen, Ken. I'm not a big monarch guy. In fact, when something big happens in the royal family, it kind of, I'm not gonna lie, it bothers me because all the TV time and all the news time is taken up with the Queen, with the royalty, with the monarch. And it's such an English thing. I have to admit, I'm gonna tell you why it bothers me. Because you're born with this privilege and you've got this power. And I just, I'm an American. We vote our officials into office, our leaders, and I believe in that. I believe in democracy. And I just can't wrap my mind around how people around the world, not just in England, I mean, there's a lot of people right here. I think there's a lot of people that feel the way I do. But there's a lot of people that really, really have a deep respect for the monarch. And one of those people is sitting right next to me, Ken Bombes.
All right. Hello, everybody, and welcome to the second episode of the Captain's Brief. And what Tom says is very true. You know, there's two sides to the two positions when it comes to the royal family. And one of them is a more progressive position where people feel that why should we even need in the year 2022 a royal family? And or why would England need this? And then there's other people that really love the tradition of it. And also there's so many other things that I believe personally, because I am a big supporter of the royal family, that it brings to the table. So I'm going to talk about a few of those things.
Real quick, Ken.
Yeah.
I heard you on the radio last week.
Right.
With Jay Oliver.
Yep.
And he's got my view. He's tired
he
of
does,
it.
Jay
he's,
does.
He's tired of it. And, well, and by the way, has this woman been buried yet?
Right.
I don't think so.
So what I would say is he does have an opposing view to me, but I think his is more enough's enough. It's just too much coverage, right?
Right.
So what I would say is, you don't have to watch this. You don't have to, but I'll tell you what. There are millions and millions of people right now glued to the TV. I'm one of them because to me it's fascinating. And I'm going to tell you why the reason I support the idea of the royal family. Because I think a lot of people just don't understand what it really is. You know, they're not ruling the British people. This is a constitutional monarchy. So they have a prime minister and they have a parliament. And they're the ones who run the government every day. In fact, the queen and the royal family are supposed to steer away from, especially the queen, the monarch, steer away from politics. They're not supposed to be involved in that. But what do they provide is tradition, which in this day and age, I think is something that's very, we need to protect. It's the tradition that they have so much of. And I remember being young and being in awe of the royal family and also almost envious that they had that system in place rather than the system that we do. You know, you look at this support that this queen has and, you know, God save the queen and how strongly the people in England feel about the queen. Even the ones that actually oppose the royal family, they're fiercely protective of the queen. And we're watching this outpouring of support right now. I can't imagine anything that compares in America right now. And what we have here in America in our system of government is at best a short-term administrator, a government administrator who leads our government. And at worst, which is far too common in my opinion these days, it's self-serving, unqualified people that put themselves before the country, right? So what does the royal family bring to the table then? Because you look, England has their politics too. They have their dirty politics. They have a prime minister. They have a parliament. But what does the royal family bring? It brings one thing is continuity. This queen has been on the throne for over 70 years. So that's many prime ministers. In fact, that's 14 U.S. presidents she's served through. That's incredible. And many of these people who are lined up, including Beckham, for 14 hours.
He's the athlete. What does he do? Soccer. He's a soccer player.
He's soccer.
He waited 14 hours?
14 hours to see the queen. And let me tell you, very patiently, and you know, when you look at that over there, the British people, the outpouring of support that the royal family got and for the queen, we have nothing that's comparable to that. I'll tell you why. So what does the royal family really bring? Well, one thing, it's tradition, which is, like I said, so important to protect nowadays, yeah. in my opinion. The other thing is continuity. This queen has been, most of these people lined up yeah. have not experienced a day of life without the queen on the throne.
Listen, I didn't want to wait 2 hours for a COVID test 2 years ago.
Yeah, so that's what I'm saying. And these people are patiently
waiting. Beckham waited how many hours?
14 hours, 14 hours to come and see the queen and pay his respects. And then the other thing that there's continuity that the queen brings to the table, right? And then there's patriotism. The British people are so fiercely protective of the royal family and the queen specifically. And now hopefully we're going to see that transition to King Charles. And it's something that they have that bonds them as a people and gives them a deep patriotism that I think they should protect fiercely. I know right now, because the queen was so beloved, that there's a lot of discussion. Everyone's saying, well, will the royal family survive? And we've seen some issues in the royal family, and they're afraid. Are people going to say, this is no longer worth it? Why are we doing this, right? Mm-hmm. But I'll tell you, I could liken this to some other things. I believe in tradition when it's good, strong tradition. Look at our military right now, and you could say the same thing, because I'm a soldier. And you could say the same thing. You know, when soldiers salute each other today, to this very day, and everyone knows that's what they do. They salute officers, and an enlisted soldier will salute an officer, and they return that salute. That stems from, in medieval times, when knights would lift the visor on their helmets to see the other knight so they could see their eyes and see who they were. Now, obviously, we don't have to do that anymore. We don't have to, but it's a strong tradition, and be very careful what you change in the military. Are there people who are going to attack these traditions? How about just saying that officers, there's enlisted and officers, they're going to say this is a class system, people are going to fight. People will get to the point where they're probably going to attack the military and the system that we've had since the beginning of our country of enlisted and non-commissioned officers and officers. There's going to be a time where they're going to try and attack that and say that this is not only a class system within the military, they're going to probably call it racist. And because, you know, they'll say, well, there's more lower economic people in the enlisted ranks than the officer ranks. These are things that are very, you have to be very careful about, because, you know, when there's a system, there's a reason they salute and show that respect. And it's not just one of privilege. I was an enlisted soldier and I was a commissioned officer. And I can tell you it's a position of service, not privilege. And the same thing with the royal family. You know, when that officer gives that order and that soldier has to go charge that machine gun, they can't be thinking twice. It has to be, you can't even have in your mind questioning that order. It has to be absolute. And the minute we start tampering with tradition like that, it's going to have far-ranging effects. And the same thing with the royal family, I feel. Be careful about what you treat frivolously and might want to try and get rid of it and say, we don't need this anymore. It's not about needing it. It's about them wanting it, and they should cherish that royal family. It's the way I feel. As far as the hours covering it, yes, it's a bit much. But if you're a fan, you watch all of it because it's fascinating. And if you're not, I could see it gets a little tiresome.
Ken puts up a great, great argument for the royal family. Yeah, I like it.
I'm a fan.
I like it. What's interesting, I didn't know that. The salute, and I'm a military guy. I was 9 years in the Air Force. The salute, it comes from the knights when they lifted up their, so you can see their eyes.
Right.
I didn't know that.
Yeah. And
should know that. I was a military guy for 9 years.
I'll tell you, there's so much. Wow. That's one thing I love about the military and why I couldn't wait to be a soldier from when I was a young child is the tradition of it. Because you don't have that in any other part of our society the way they do. And I think we should be very protective of it. Everything you have to be very protective against progressing to a point where, to a fault, I think.
Well, I was a non-commissioned officer in the Air Force. Ken was a non-commissioned officer. Then he became an officer. He got his commission. So I will salute you. Tom. And with that, I think that this whole debate, royal, anti-royal, is captured brilliantly and in a very, very funny way in the movie Monty Python and the Holy Grail. You got that, Ant?
I'm Arthur, King of the Britons. Whose castle is that?
King of the who?
The Britons.
Who are the Britons?
Well, we all are. We are all Britons. And I am your king.
I didn't know we had a king. I thought we were an autonomous collective.
You're fooling yourself. We're living in a dictatorship. A self-perpetuating autocracy in which the working classes...
Oh, there you go, bringing class into it again.
Well, that's what it's all about. If only people would...
Please, good people. I am in haste. Who lives in that castle?
No one lives there.
Then who is your lord?
We don't have a lord.
What? I told you, we're an anarcho-syndicalist commune. We take it in turns to act as a sort of executive officer for the week.
Yes.
But all the decisions of that officer have to be ratified at a special bi-weekly meeting.
Yes, I see.
By a simple majority in the case of purely internal affairs.
Be quiet.
But by a two-thirds majority in the case of more...
Be quiet. I order you to be quiet.
Order? Who does he think he is?
I'm your king.
Well, I didn't vote for you.
You don't vote for kings.
Well, how'd you become king then?
The Lady of the Lake. Her arm clad in the purest shimmering samite held aloft Excalibur from the bosom of the water, signifying by divine providence that I, Arthur, was to carry Excalibur. That is why I'm your king. Listen, strange women lying in ponds distributing swords is no basis for a system of government. Supreme executive power derives from a mandate from the masses, not from some farcical aquatic ceremony.
Be quiet!
But you can't expect to wield supreme executive power just because some watery tart threw a sword at you.
Shut up!
I mean, if I went round saying I was an emperor just because some moistened bint had lobbed a scimitar at me, they'd put me away.
Shut up! Will you shut up?
Ah, now we see the violence inherent in the system.
Shut up!
Oh, come and see the violence inherent in the system! Help! Help! I'm being repressed!
All right. So that's excellent. Okay. It's a classic scene.
It's a classic scene. It definitely captures the argument, not the argument, but the debate that we're having about royalty.
It does.
I keep a list on my phone of my favorite movies, and I have them categorize them. And on the top of my comedy list is Monty Python on the Holy Grail. Yeah. When I was a kid, I grew up, I would come home, you know, when you're a teenager, I would come home at 11 o'clock at night, and I would, I think on Sunday nights, on channel 13, that channel that nobody watches, back when we were kids, the Monty Python and the Flying Circus would come on.
Yeah.
And I became a Monty Python fan from that day on, from that night on, and I still am to this day.
Yeah.
Funniest movie, in my opinion, ever made, Monty Python and the Holy Grail.
So it's great. It's a great scene. It's perfect for what we're talking about. And by the way, on more realistic terms, you're going to see this debate play out now, I'm assuming. Right now, we're in the very middle of this, the ceremonies, and you're going to see the king's coronation. Which is another point, is that a lot of people don't understand, is that the royal families and the monarch, it's a position where they're granted their power by God. It's a religious
position. See, I didn't know that. You told me that last week, and I was surprised to hear that. I did not know that God, religion really entered into this whole world.
And I'm sure so many people who are watching our show have seen The Crown, and I've seen it several times. And I, you know, of course this is a show, and there's entertainment built into it, but there's a lot of accurate historical facts that come out in that show. I'm watching it. I highly recommend it. Great show. Yeah. Once you start, you'll be glued to it. It's not boring.
Mm-hmm.
So, Tom, let's move on and talk about our next topic.
What do you want to talk about? You want to talk about Ukraine? You want to talk about China?
We're going to talk about Ukraine and a little bit of China because it's relevant right now.
Here's the thing that I think about when I think about Ukraine. And I support Ukraine. I want Ukraine to win. I am against what Putin is doing over there. I think it's a travesty what's going on over there and all the lives that have been lost. But here's the thing about it that worries me. I know we're giving them a lot of monetary support, and we're sending weapons over there. You know, the fact that Ukraine has turned this around, and they're starting to retake territory.
Right.
And Putin is kind of on his heels.
Yeah.
It's almost kind of a scenario where, be careful what you wish for, almost, because it's one thing to have a wild animal, right? You're confronted with a wild animal. Try being confronted with a wild animal when it's cornered and it's got nuclear weapons.
Right.
Right? And that's what worries me about this. If Putin is on his heels, he's not just going to say, oh, okay, well, we'll just quit. That ain't going to happen.
Right, right.
He's not going to say, well, we'll take, you know, if he finds himself in a position where he might lose this war, what I'm trying to say is it worries me what this man is capable of. He might be capable of using a nuke.
So,
and that's what worries me.
So
your thoughts?
You're right, and let's talk about that. But I've been on the radio since the invasion first occurred. I've been on the radio consistently as a subject matter expert to talk about this based on my experience as a military intelligence officer. And I can tell you, You know, I understood in the very beginning of this that many people, I think, had a false sense of the capabilities of the Russian military. Having been a former Army intelligence officer, I was a little more in tune with, you know, this is not, they are not American military. And not only that, they are not equivalent with the U.S. military by any means, but they're not even equivalent with the former Soviet military. You know, there's a lot of corruption. It's not a well-run military. They don't have a strong NCO corps. There's a lot of reasons I could go into. But now let's fast forward. What they did have is overwhelming force, massive amounts of weapons and ammunition, right? And that's what they brought to the table. I think through sanctions, but really more through the vast support that Ukraine has received from allies, the West primarily, in the form of funding, weapons, and ammunition, they've been able to slowly, first of all, defend themselves, right?
Yeah.
They've been able to keep Russia from moving into Kiev. That was critical in the early stage of the war. Most people, including myself, thought that after week one that Putin was going to be standing in Kiev, and this would have been a completely different story. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Well, what people weren't considering was the strength and the fortitude of the Ukrainian people and their military. Their military was well-trained, and it showed in the very beginning. Plus, it's always harder to invade when you're the aggressor. And you're the defender. It's always easier to be a defender. It takes like, I think it's like 10 to 1 troops if you want to go invade a country for the offense to defense. That's how much it takes because the defense can be well dug in. We saw that. We saw that in Kiev and other cities, right? And that played a part.
Yeah.
Now what I think you're seeing is Ukraine has had such wide support from their allies that they've been able to sustain and finally... Their troops are well-trained by the West, which is really playing a pivotal part of this. And then once they got those advanced weapon systems, like the artillery with further range, it made a drastic difference.
Yeah.
So where do we stand now? I'll tell you, they just had a very big meeting in Uzbekistan with the president of China. Not just with them, but among these people was the president of China and Vladimir Putin. And everybody was speculating, could this be the beginning of this axis of evil where China's going to now start supporting them directly with funding and weapons and ammunition? Mm-hmm. And the short answer is, it does not look that way.
You don't think so?
No, what it's looking like is India, in this meeting, India and China are questioning this war and questioning Vladimir Putin in this war. And they're sort of stepping back.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, so I'll tell you, Tom.
Yeah.
China... Yes, they are one of our fiercest enemies, probably our greatest enemy.
I would say so.
Our greatest enemy right now, and they need to be treated as such. They are not an ally. They are not just a trading partner. However, they have a much more pragmatic view on the world, and they're very patient. They have plans, and their plans could last decades, and they're going to wait for the right time. They see what Putin has done to his country, and they've seen the sanctions and the unity that came on from the allies. And I don't think they want any part of this right now. Not yet. Not now. Mm-hmm. And I think that they are going to fall short of providing that support to Putin.
That came out of this meeting. I didn't know that. And that's a good thing. That's what you want.
Yeah.
You don't want Putin fighting this war with the support of China.
Right. Absolutely but not. To your point earlier, what do we have now? We have a wounded and dangerous Vladimir Putin.
It's almost like be careful what you wish for.
So there's two things here that could... come to a play in this scenario. And one of them is that we have a dangerous Putin with nuclear weapons.
Right.
And the worst case scenario, and we usually play these scenarios out as military intelligence officers, in the worst case scenario, you have a Vladimir Putin that has a sort of scorched earth policy, and he's not a good loser. We all know that.
Right.
And he either does devastating attacks and continues on civilian infrastructure, where we've already seen signs of this, or in a worst case scenario, he actually uses one of those low-yield tactical nuclear weapons that we've heard about since the beginning of this as he leaves. Because remember, Vladimir Putin has that escalate to de-escalate policy. Whereas if it's a scenario where there's a lot of people being killed and he's not doing well, they could escalate to a battlefield nuke. And they could use that as a way to de-escalate overall.
A battlefield nuke.
Yeah.
That's different than a...
Oh, yes. It's what they call a low yield or a tactical nuke. Devastating. And there will be effects in the countries around there. But it's not the type of...
Well, that's another question. If there's effects in countries around them, are those NATO countries? Yeah. And if they are NATO countries,
yeah.
To what degree are we going to get involved in this?
See, that's the big question.
That's another thing. Yeah.
And look, we could go to the broader question, which I've challenged since the very beginning of this, I think is a mistake, is we have basically said, this guy's got nukes, he's crazy, let's back off. But that is not a strategy. Ronald Reagan, in my opinion, would never have taken this strategy. You know, I know people say, yeah, but what if, you know, he has nuclear weapons? Well, what is the other strategy? We're going to let countries with nuclear capabilities chase us around the world and bow down to them? It's not a strategy.
It's a good point.
That is not a strategy.
It's a good
and,
point.
And, you know, we have nuclear weapons, too. And listen, I'm not suggesting that we want this a nuclear war. Nobody is suggesting that. But it's a deterrent. You have to realize that's a real deterrent.
Yeah.
And what I think now, the biggest thing we have going for us, two things. First of all, I think you see two countries that Putin saw as allies backing away, India and China, his two probably the biggest supporters that made a difference to his efforts there in Ukraine, backing away, it seems. The other thing is going to be, does Putin, he has internal, people would think that, well, this is a dictator and he doesn't worry about his people. Well, he does. And he has internal pressure right now to the point there's actually elected officials grouping together calling for him to step down or even impeach him.
That's amazing.
And listen, yeah. He is not impervious to that happening in Russia. He does pay attention to the temperature of his people and the politics in Russia. So it's something to pay. I think that one is probably the biggest thing, the biggest support right now for Ukraine, and they're wanting them to get Russia out of their country. Mm-hmm. It's going to probably come from the Russian people, and they're tired. They see not only have they lost so many people, but they're losing now. Now right. They're losing. They're being chased out of Ukraine. So I'll finish with this, at least this segment. Russia has to make some decisions. Vladimir Putin in Uzbekistan just recently said, my primary mission here was the Donbas, which had a lot of Russian control in that region,
right.
Except for some cities. He's saying now all of a sudden he's not ridding the country of Nazis. Right now he's saying it was just the Donbas. The problem we face is President Zelensky, on the other hand, says, I'm not giving up an inch of Ukraine.
That's right.
That's where we're at. That's what is going to be the ultimate focus on any possible diplomatic solution is the Donbas. And is President Zelensky and Vladimir Putin willing to get to a point where they can come to just end up the war right now and work out these negotiations somewhat peacefully? That's where we're at.
I heard Zelensky wants Crimea back.
Yeah.
I've heard that too.
Yeah.
I read that.
Yeah.
Wow. So, well, easy segue into China. And let me tell you about some. I'm going to give you my thoughts on China.
Yeah, do that.
Here's what bothers me about China, and then we'll get your thoughts afterwards. First of all, China has threatened us in the past. China has nukes and has a very, very significant military. China wants to be the world superpower. No doubt about that. This president, Xi, is now like a king, right?
Yeah.
They got rid of the system where they had similar to us. Where
he extended his terms indefinitely, pretty much.
Gone. Yeah. He's like the king now over there. And I'm going to bring up a point that you've talked about in the past. I've heard you talk about this on the radio. We have done mock naval exercises, correct?
Right.
In the
yes.
Pacific.
Yes.
And during at the end of these mock naval exercises, where we're mocking that we're going to war with what, China?
China, yeah.
We've come out not on top of
not
some
on
of
top.
These. We've lost. Here's some other things that bother me about China. The Uyghurs. I tried Googling the Uyghurs. Do you know what starts with a U?
Yes. Yeah, I'm familiar.
But anyway, I Googled it and I read about it. These people are enslaved.
Yeah.
These are Muslims, correct?
Mm-hmm.
That are in China. And they're basically in slavery. They're being abused in so many different ways.
Right.
Sexually, the women are abused sexually.
Yeah.
And it gets very little airplay on TV here in the States. But you've got so many industries that are so beholden to China. LeBron James, there's a big controversy in the NBA in terms of his his loyalty to China because they make so much money.
Right.
And then you've got other people that are the opposite. And they don't want anything to do with China because they don't believe in what's going on over in China with the Uyghurs. And it's a big deal.
Yeah, so this is the underlying problem with China. I've talked about this for so long on the radio and in some articles, is that China is our sworn enemy. They make no bones about that. It's part of their doctrine to surpass and overcome the United States.
Right.
We're their enemy. But we treat them sometimes like we treat Austria or like just a trade partner.
Right.
And one of the reasons for that is because of the dependency that we've established trade-wise with us in China.
Real quick, Ken.
Yeah.
I've made it a habit in the last like few months because I watch what goes on with China. When I pick up a product, I look at I look for the label.
Right, right.
I'm telling you, man, 70% of the stuff I pick up is made in China.
Right.
It's amazing.
And I'll tell you what, this is one of the few places, because I'm a capitalist, that I think we need some more government intervention. You know, when we had our COVID crisis here in this country and learned that such a vast majority of our pharmaceuticals that we were dependent on were being made in China, there was calls at that time. We need to change this. We cannot be dependent on them for things that are critical for our security, our national security. And what have we done since then? We're still dependent on China for so many things, and that needs to be changed.
Right.
We need to treat them exactly like what they are, which is a sworn enemy of the United States. So you have so much business and so much big business lobby because they are doing business and saving a lot of money doing business with China that they don't want that. And I think that's one of the big problems we have.
Mm-hmm.
But they are an enemy and we need to treat them as such, call them that every opportunity we have and not accept the fact that it's almost like we turned a blind eye because we know that we have such strong trade dependency with this country. That needs to change. You know, I of course like when things are made in America, like I think most Americans should, but it's more than just being patriotic. This is national security we're talking about here. We've made ourselves dependent on a country that has a much more militarily powerful than Russia, and also has shown such aggressive action recently.
Yep.
You know, all we did is our Speaker of the House went on a trip to Taiwan, and we were at the brink of war. As far as their narrative was. We try to downplay that, but they were doing massive military exercises, unprecedented military exercises where they were doing live fire exercises and bringing ships and planes into areas they are not supposed to. And we're at a very dangerous time in our history and need to take this very seriously.
Mm-hmm.
And I would just say this, you know, when you look at all of the threats, Russia, China, Iran, North Korea, all of these threats that we're facing, not to mention terrorism, which we're going to see is going to pose a much greater threat to us as Afghanistan's allowed to cultivate under the Taliban. And we have all these threats. Americans need to stop worrying and stop having so much concentration on domestic nonsense and political partisan fighting and focus on the big fight. And focus on building our military capabilities to where they should be, and they are not. Like you said, there's a retired naval officer who was involved in these exercises where they do a mock exercise annually. They were doing it, and it was supposed to be China moves on Taiwan, and what happens when the U.S. intervenes with our allies.
Mm-hmm.
And every time they ran that exercise, the U.S. loses in that scenario.
That's a scary scenario.
I know there's been some think tanks that have come out and done similar training exercises, and they say that the U.S. could win.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, that's a big if, and I think that we need to be really coming together. And with all of these threats, I think I've said this once before, in my lifetime, I think we've faced the greatest threats we ever have right now in American history. That's what I feel.
It's very interesting, our connection with China. I saw a fellow on the news the other day. He was, they did a little interview with him. He came up with a different way to make rounds, ammunition, bullets.
I saw this.
You saw that?
Yeah.
And he's, instead of using brass, he's using some other material, and it's like one third the weight of what a brass bullet would be.
Right.
So when you think about putting a million rounds or tens of thousands of rounds on a helicopter to transport it, you're looking at one third the weight. That's a big deal.
And by
That's
the way,
a big deal.
By the way, or on the back of an infantryman, which I've done, makes a very big deal.
It makes a big difference, one third the weight. But also, with that being said, where do you think we get most of our brass from?
China.
So, there you go.
Tom, we could talk all day about the different items
that
we are dependent on China for. And it leaves us in a position of great vulnerability. And the thing is, we recognize it. We know this, and we're not doing enough
right.
to counter that.
Right.
You know, we have to stop treating them like an international trading partner. We need to stop treating them like an ally and treat them for what exactly
absolutely.
They are, which and is a sworn enemy of the U.S.
Absolutely. Biden had a phone call. President Biden had a phone call with Xi a while back.
Right.
It was like months ago, maybe a
year
ago.
Yep.
Here's what bugs me about that. We never got the transcript. What was the phone call? What did he say? Did he ask about the virus?
Right.
Did he ask about the Uyghurs? Did he ask about Taiwan?
Yeah.
We don't know because we never got a transcript.
Right.
I would love to know what went on in that phone conversation.
You're right. And here's what I'll tell you that. As an Army intelligence officer,
mm-hmm.
this issue came about with President Trump on a phone call with Ukraine, correct?
Right.
And I have to say, I am someone who protects the privacy of a president in his phone calls. I mean,
yeah.
We have to guard against a time when if presidents know that every time they're on the phone with our president, the world is going to read it on the cover of the New York Times, they're not going to say much. We're going to have no more meaningful communication between world leaders if every time they talk, they know it's going to be on the cover of the paper. So with that being said, I still think his administration could share some insight as to
right.
where the president stands after his call with that
right.
Chinese leader without giving up all. There should be some things that should stay confidential. I agreed with that theory under President Trump.
Yep.
I agree with it with President Obama, and I agree with it now with President Biden, that they should be able to have that confidentiality. Otherwise, it's like I said, be careful what you ask for, because
yeah.
it's going to get to a point where we're not going to be able to have those frank conversations, which we need to have, our presidents
mm-hmm.
need to have once in a while.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
All right. So we've got Mar-a-Lago real quick. And I think I listened to you on the radio the other day. You brought up a good point.
Yeah.
Listen. President Trump should not have had those documents in Mar-a-Lago at his resort. I totally agree
completely
with right. that. That was wrong. But it's quite curious that this whole raid, and many in the media are not calling it a raid. They argue with that term. I think when the FBI is going through your wife's wardrobe closet and your son's bedroom, when you're not there, I'm going to call it a raid.
Yeah,
I think it was a raid, but it's quite curious the timing of it. I mean, the midterms are coming up; they are dirtying this guy up the best they can. That's the way
yeah.
I feel about it.
Yeah. So here's the thing with setting precedent. If I were to be asked, do you think at face value, with the information the FBI had, Department of Justice, they had a reason to get a search warrant legally and go in there to get these documents? I do. I think he had classified information there. And I'm sure within the power that the federal government, the FBI, the Department of Justice have a very powerful toolbox. I think that they had enough information to do that.
Right.
However, the problem they really fit this is the problem with setting a precedent. We had that, unfortunately for the FBI and the DOJ, not long ago, we had another high-ranking government official, namely the Secretary of State, Hillary Clinton, who had a situation where she intentionally used a private server and there was classified information on there. It seems, anyway, at face value, that the treatment in that case,
mm-hmm.
than the treatment in this scenario with
right.
these documents is very different. In fact, as a retired detective, you know, in that case, with the bleach bit and destroying, that's obstruction. I mean, that's textbook
bit.
Of obstruction.
Mm-hmm.
Also, I would just say one other thing that the DNI, the Director of National Intelligence, is doing this big study, this report to say what potential vulnerability might we have because of the documents that are at Mar-a-Lago if they got into the hands of the enemy. Well, again, probably a valid point. I think I'm an intelligence officer. However, where was that DNI call when they had the 32,000 emails?
Couldn't agree more.
And the problem with that is that most intelligence experts and most intelligence professionals,
yeah.
myself included, that was digital, her information. Most intelligence professionals, it's not a maybe. That information is in the hands of our enemies. They have it. It was in the equivalent of a Yahoo account. You know, that information was unprotected. They have
right.
that information.
Right.
So all I'm going to know is, where is the big call for the DNI report for that?
Right.
So what I'm saying is, this is the shame and this is the risk of setting a precedent when you treated someone in a similar scenario with such light hands, such kid gloves, is that now you have a situation where
right.
he should not have had that information there. No. And I'm sure they have legal cause to get in there, and we're going to learn to conduct a search warrant. But now you've brought your credibility into question
right.
because someone of another party was
right.
treated so very differently.
Mm-hmm.
That's the real problem here. And I think they need to get over this to improve what was the great reputation of the FBI as our national, as our top-tier law enforcement agency in this country.
Absolutely, I agree with that. We have definitely, two standards of justice in this country. I'm sorry. That is so wrong, what went on back then. And
yeah.
for the FBI to be able to go in and raid Mar-a-Lago after what went on with Hillary Clinton is a travesty. Real quick and kind of funny, I think. Back during the campaign, Trump and Hillary, and you know how Trump calls her, you know, crooked Hillary?
Right.
We have a parkway out here on Long Island, and one of the exit signs, it's got a road that goes off of the parkway, is called a Crooked Hill Road. It's out here on Long Island, Suffolk County. Some vandals back during the campaign, they got some spray paint, and they renamed it Crooked Hillary Road.
I'm not surprised.
Anyway, real quick, the pillow guy.
Right.
The pillow guy, Mike Lindell.
Yeah.
He was served with a subpoena.
He was recently, yeah.
At a fast food restaurant. And I think it has something to do with the voting machines. Those voting machines.
Right.
There's some controversy surrounding the voting machines. So he got served with a subpoena. He's going to end up going
yeah.
to court. Hey, Ann, I think we have, he actually has a new commercial.
Yeah, well, hold on. Before we get to his commercial, Tom, I'll just add one thing to what you were just talking about, is that, you know, I was asked on the radio this week, why, you know, do you think that they were able to, you know, serve him this subpoena? And why was he targeted like this? Well, I think that anyone involved in this case who was around during that time and close to President Trump, if they're not assuming that at this stage in the investigation that their phones and texts are being listened to or monitored, or if they, you know, could possibly have, you know,
mm-hmm.
obviously they'd have court authorization for this, I think they're crazy.
Right.
So I think that that's exactly what probably happened here, is they have reason to believe that he has information that might help them in this investigation.
Okay.
But you're right. He was at a
yeah.
drive-through window.
Yeah.
He was served a subpoena.
So to wrap it up, Ken's going to give his final thoughts, and that'll do it for the week, right?
Yeah. Right. Excellent. So we covered a lot today.
Yeah.
Next week, we're going to be talking about China. We're going to be talking about the southern border and the threats that we face there. And we're also going to talk about any events that happen from now to then. And that'll be kind of the template we use going forward for our episodes. So we thank everybody for joining us this week, and we look forward to seeing you next week. Thank you.